Good afternoon. The title of my presentation is Muslim Personal Status Laws, a Blessing or a Curse? And through my presentation, I'm trying to highlight some misunderstanding about the Sharia and the prevalent misunderstanding, the prevalent assumption that Sharia oppresses women. So, in 2003, a group of women in Bahrain launched a severe campaign for reforming personal status laws. Personal status laws are family laws that deal with divorce, marriage, and inheritance. And their argument is simple. They, and I quote, "We find each Sharia qadi, qadi means judge, ruling according to his whim. You even find a number of different ruling on the same question, which has brought things to a very bad state of affairs in Sharia courts. The demand for the promulgation of this law aim at eliminating many problems and at unifying rulings. It would reassure people of the conduct of litigation and would guarantee women the rights rather than leaving them at the mercy of fate." In other words, they were against the idea that Sharia is a case law, and they call for what Judith Tucker called legal centralism. And what actually strikes me is that these women did not aware of the specific nature of the Sharia. And this is what I'm trying to highlight here. My paper thesis is that the demand of the Bahraini feminist is an extension of a colonial legal discourse that prevailed in the Middle East since the 19th century. And this discourse calls that the adoption of Western legal institutions and the Western laws will definitely result in the advancements of women's rights. Second, I argue, by examining codifications experience in different Muslims' law, what happened is that the codification of law actually result in deterioration of women's rights and not enhancing them. So, what is Sharia? Sharia, it is not only a law or Islamic law that regulate relationship between people. It is more than this. It is, as like Walid Halaq said, it is a discursive practice. It permeates every aspect of society, culture, political life, and so on. So it is a grassroots movement emanating from the professional groups and legal institutions. And it is very interesting to know that the court actually took place in the marketplace, in home, in mosques, which means that the judge was very close and had a very close interaction with the people themselves. And actually, this assert that the authority of law, it is social. The Sharia law was very well known for its flexibility, because if a judge now has a case, how he decide? First, he returned to the Quran or the sacred book of the Muslims. Then if he finds that the book itself is silent on this matter, he returned to the Sunnah or to the deeds of the Prophet, peace be upon him. If he found that the Sunnah does not include anything about the issue, then he turned to the jurist opinion. And actually, Islam has four major schools of jurisprudence: Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanafi, and Hanbali. And in each school of law, we have majority opinion and the minority opinion. Plus, also we have different opinion offered by different jurists. So which means that the jurist in deciding a case, he is not limited to a certain law. He has a sea of law of opinion. He can refer to it to reach his decision, which means that it's a very flexible system. And second, which is very important, we have a different interpretation of the Quran and the Sunnah, and we don't have an authoritative interpretation, which means we don't have an interpretation which dominates. No one claims that he represents the most authoritative or the most accurate interpretation of the Quran, which also implies that Sharia was very tolerant. Okay. Also, how the jurist or the qadi or the judge become a judge, actually, if you read Colonial Egypt by Timothy Mitchell. Timothy Mitchell actually, he praised the Al-Azhar University system because he said that we have the professor sitting on the ground, surrounded by the students, and he have a huge a different selection of books, and he tried to discuss these books with his student. The student has a freedom to choose whoever teacher he wants to teach with them. He can attend whatever session he wants. He spent several years until he received a license that enabled him to practice to be a judge. So, what happened is that during the 19th century and with the advent of colonization, the colonial power tried to dominate not only the political and the economic life of the Middle East, but also the legal aspect, because legal aspect is an important element of the culture itself. And it is, as Lord Cromer said, the new generation of Egyptian has to be pursued or forced into inhabiting the true spread of Western civilization. And actually, the colonial power to justify the idea of colonization and so on, they came with the idea, we are here to save the people, the Middle East, we are here to teach them how to progress and how to advance. So, and they actually rely on writings made by Orientalists who, unfortunately, they relied on translated works, which are, in most cases, are not accurate. And so, and they tried to spread the idea that the real predicament of the Muslim world lie on the Sharia, because Sharia, it is not flexible and so on, which is not true. So they propagate the idea, we need an important reform of the legal system. And actually, legal discourse, as Foucault argued, it is a different form of power and domination. And it established social behavior and create discourse that shape individual desire and subjectivity. It is another form how the colonial power try to control the cognitive aspects of the colonized people. Foucault also has a very interesting things about truth. What the colonial power tried to propagate is that legal reform, it is a truth. It is very important to adopt a Western legal system. It is a guarantee that you will develop. So they propagate a truth. And also a truth also reflects a power of relationship. It is a truth, it is subjective truth. Actually, the colonial power convinces the Ottoman Empire that the codification of law associated with the import of Western laws will definitely result in the progress of the empire. And since this time, the Eurocentric perception of progress had a powerful hold on both the unconscious and the conscientious thought of the Middle Eastern people. And it is very strange that at the time of these people succeeded in liberalizing themselves from the political domination of the West, they are still trapped unconsciously owing to the economic and the legal legacy of the West. Okay. And actually, my thesis supports the argument that there is a close relationship, and this is actually my area of interest, there is a close relationship between law and the politics. You cannot separate them. Because legal positivism school says that law is independent of politics. For example, Carlson argues that law is independent of moral and the politics. McCormack says politics is not law and law it is not politics. Hart argues that law is evolved outside of the moral and the political values of the atmosphere in which it's embedded. The legal colonial discourse asserted that political development such colonization had a great impact on the formation of the law. What was the impact of the codification of the Sharia? It is that, and here I quote Wael Hallaq, it passed a very harsh verdict on the entire history as it puts an end to a very flexible, competent system. The codification system resulted to the marginalization of the Sharia, and it replaced a very rich, diverse, complicated text of Sharia with a singular Sharia-based legal law. So the judge now, instead of having a diverse source, he only have one source with a very limited number of rules, and he has to abide by these rules. And of course, associated with the codification movement, is that the Western education, the old traditional system, educational system was end. Now the judge received Western education system, which means that in some cases, or most cases, he is not well familiar with the different schools, or he is not competent like the traditional judge with different school of jurisprudence and thought. And very important is that the new judge, as I said, it's a structure from scratch, in the sense that they didn't turn to the president what happened in the pre-modern Sharia courts and to know how the judge reached his decision. And concerning family laws, because this is my topic, they were shaped by the Napoleon Code. The Napoleon Code actually rests on the idea that man is superior than woman because he is the most competent individual that he can manage the affairs of the household. Okay. To make my point clear, I compare between the pre-modern, between the Sharia courts and the modern courts in relating to issues relating to marriage, divorce, and honor crime. Marriage. What happened is that during the Sharia courts, the woman had the right to insert condition in her marriage contract. And for example, she can say, my husband shouldn't get another wife. He should treat me well. He should treat my children from previous marriage well. And if he didn't fulfill his promise, he has to divorce her. And the husband respects this. What happened in Egypt, for example, when law reforms adopted in 1920 and 1929, they deprived women from this right. Actually, the right to insert condition on the marriage contract maintain a balance of relationship within the marriage household. But when 1920s and the 1929, when we adopted, put an end to this balance, and I was astonished that it was known as this 1920s as a progressive laws. And more importantly, in 2000s, when the new marriage contract was implemented in Egypt, which allows women to insert condition and so on, what happened is that women refrained from inserting conditions because what happened is that the prospective husband refused the idea that his wife to insert condition on the marriage contract. This he felt as a humiliation to his masculinity. Concerning divorce, the qadi or the judge in the pre-colonial courts, what it's referred to different mazhab, different cases, in order to protect the needs of the litigants. And here there is a very interesting case that took place in Palestine in the 17th century. It is mentioned by Judith Tucker. And what happened is that a very poor woman went to a judge and he asked him for getting a judicial divorce. He said that my husband is very poor. He left me. He traveled and he left me without enough sources. So I need to get a divorce. And the qadi tell her, fine, I need two witnesses that prove this. He brought two witnesses, which proved her claims, and she got a divorce. 3 months later, she married. But during that time, her ex-husband returned, and her ex-husband followed the Hanafi school of jurisprudence. According to the Hanafi school of jurisprudence, the fact is that the husband failed in sustaining his wife, it is not a condition or it is not a ground that can provide women for getting a divorce. So the husband go to another qadi and he told him the marriage, the second marriage of my wife, it is not legal, it is against Hanafi school of jurisprudence and so on. So the qadi said, he kept in his mind the interest of the wife, and he referred to what the Shafi'i said, that in case the husband failed in maintaining his wife, the wife has to get a divorce. This means the flexibility that the qadi does not stick to his madhab. He go to others' madhab, or he refer to others' madhab. And more important, during the Sharia courts, the qadi or the judge cannot force any woman to stay with a husband she didn't like him. Okay. If you compare this nowadays with women with a codification system, it is very hard to get a divorce. And in Egypt, for example, to get a divorce, she has to prove that a darar or a harm took place. And it's in the, and for example, if it is a domestic violence, it is very hard to prove it. And in some cases, if it is proved, the class issue play an important role. In some cases, if she is a well-off lady, the judge said, okay, I can give her a divorce. But if she is a poor lady, he will not give her a divorce under the context that poor women are subject to this harsh treatment, which I find nonsense. And concerning honor crimes, in the Sharia courts, actually, a woman, if she faced rape, she can go to the judge and ask for compensation. And even if a woman commit adultery, her relative, her male relative, didn't have the right to kill her. Like if you compare nowadays, for example, the Jordanian penal code give the husband the if he kill one of his relatives because of sexual misconduct, he was exempted from punishment, okay. Which is very strange. This is not the case in the pre-colonial courts. My conclusion is that power over others can take different form, can take what Marx said, false consciousness or Gramsci culture hegemony. And second, the idea that the Western legal system succeeded in protecting women's rights does not necessarily mean if I adopt this Western legal system in Eastern countries will definitely result to progress of women's rights, because in our case, what happened is the reverse. And that the codification of personal status laws is an example of what Dunsey and Kennedy called the revolutionary change that affects the distribution of power between men and women. But in our case, the revolutionary was not positive, it was negative. And before I finish, I want best to mention this. There are a number of important sources. You can refer to it if you want to know more about the status of law before the codification and so on, and the critiques, actually, of the codification system. We have Len Welchman. Len Welchman wrote a lot about the Islamic law reforms that took place during the 19th and the 20th century. We have Wael Hallaq, which is a very interesting book about Sharia, and he described how it was a very flexible system and how the codification system had a negative impact on the evolution of Sharia. We have Zachary Lockman, his interesting book, Contending Vision of the Middle East, when he criticized the idea that there is a misunderstanding that Islam represents a homogeneous entity, which is not the case. The Islam that is, there are commonalities, but also there are, at the same time, there are differences. Islam that is practiced in Saudi Arabia, a little bit is different from the Islam that is practiced in Egypt, and so on. We have Nathan Brown, who is a very good expert on Egyptian, actually, constitution. You can resort to him. We have Ibrahim Musa, shed the light on how the colonization negatively affects Islamic law. And we have Amira Sombon and Judith Ticker, who are two very important feminists who wrote a lot about the court cases, and they tried to use court cases in the Ottoman period to prove that the status of women before the codification system was much, much better than now. And we have Laish and Khaled Abulfadl. Khaled Abulfadl, The Great Theft, it's a good source to explain what was the reasons behind the prevalence of different extremist Muslims movement nowadays. For further information, you can contact me at Mona Ruby at AUC, and thanks for your attention.